In July 1945, scientists detonated Trinity, the world's first nuclear bomb. At the time, no one was sure what was going to happen. Scientists were even concerned the Earth's atmosphere would catch on fire. But the test was a terrifying success, and it led to an international arms race. The United States conducted over 200 atmospheric weapons tests for two key reasons: grandstanding and fine-tuning. They wanted to prove their military might and make better, more powerful nuclear weapons. So they tested out new designs in the air, on the ground, and at sea. All of these massive fireballs were captured by strategically placed cameras around a test site, and then analyzed by scientists. The big number they were after? The yield, or the amount of energy released. These films hold the best scientific data we have of our nuclear potential. That is, until a weapons physicist decades later found out that the data from these films might be a bit off.
I was asked by my boss to write this computer code that would predict nuclear fallout, and I couldn't seem to get the answer to agree, no matter what I did.
That's Greg Spriggs, a weapons physicist with the Lawrence Livermore National Laboratory.
And I kept saying, I'm not doing anything wrong in my computer code. Typical scientific answer, right? It's always somebody else's fault, not yours.
For weapons physicists like Greg, computer codes are everything. They're used to verify the thousands of thermonuclear warheads on standby all across the country. And the original data for those codes came in part from these films.
That's the benefit of the data. It provides ground truth to us, the reality. And it gives everybody a warm, fuzzy feeling back in Washington.
If it ever comes to a point that we have to use a nuke, it better work. So Greg is working on a special project to scan and reanalyze all of the old films and make sure the data is up to snuff. To do that, he had to track down thousands of Cold War-era film canisters. They'd been sitting in high-security vaults for decades and hadn't been seen by the public.
Some of the films had decomposed to the point where they had turned to dust.
The only way to accurately study these films is to digitally scan them, and Greg needed an expert in film preservation. So he brought in Jim Moy. For Jim, each film is a mini time capsule.
You know, it's kind of cool to be opening something and having no idea what's there.
Jim processes each nuclear film with this Hollywood-style scanner. So far, they've digitally scanned over 4,000 films. Then came the work of analyzing them.
There are four major effects. The first one I'll call prompt radiation.
Greg spends a lot of time watching bombs explode.
And these are the prompt neutrons that are coming off of the fission process.
We're looking at House Atomic 120256, the last nuclear shot before all atmospheric testing came to a complete stop in 1962.
The next major effect is what's called the shockwave, a big high-density air region that is moving through the atmosphere at very high speeds.
Measuring the size of a shockwave over time can reveal how much energy a bomb releases.
So this shockwave is moving very, very fast, and it's a high-density region. And when it hits something, you can imagine like standing in a hurricane, having that wind blowing at you at 200 miles an hour. Well, this is much, much higher speed.
Back in the 1950s, though, the shockwave was calculated by hand using a device called a codograph. They projected the film onto a grid and advanced it frame by frame. Scientists were doing this manually and very quickly, a process prone to human error.
We found that some of those yields could be off by as much as 20 or 30%.
But now, with these films digitized, Greg can analyze every single pixel in the fireball's edge. This means, for the very first time, we're able to get a more accurate sense of a bomb's yield.
The next effect was the thermal blast. When the shockwave moves through the atmosphere, it also heats the air, and it heats it to very high temperatures, and that hot air then starts to radiate thermal energy.
Two pulses emerge from a fireball. The first pulse happens within 81 milliseconds and has 0.6% of the thermal radiation. The second pulse carries about 99% of the total thermal radiation from the blast.
And then the fourth major effect, of course, is nuclear fallout.
The films can't measure nuclear fallout, but measuring the cloud height can give experts a sense of the extent of the damage.
I found that those cloud heights could be off by as much as 10 or 15%, which makes a big difference in nuclear fallout.
By pinpointing more precise yields, Greg can update computer models to estimate the damage from a bomb in different scenarios. Ultimately, they're perfecting data for nuclear weapons that will hopefully never be used. Still, the pursuit is worth it.
This is something new. This is kind of what scientists live for, is to kind of push the frontier forward just a little bit.
There's something unnerving about watching these mushroom clouds. And while we aren't testing nuclear weapons anymore, these films stand as a terrifying reminder of our nuclear past and potential. When a nuclear weapon is detonated, radioactive particles are thrown up in the atmosphere and come back down as fallout. So what does nuclear fallout do to your body? Check out our video here. Thanks for watching Seeker, and be sure to like and subscribe for new videos every day.